यस्मान् नो विजते लोको
यस्मान् नो विजते लोको
लोकान् नो विजते चया
लोकान् नो विजते चया
हर्षम रसा भयोद्वेगे
हर्षम हर्षा भयोद्वेगे
मुक्ताया साच मे प्रिया
मुक्ताया साच मे प्रिया यस्मान् नो विजते लोको
यस्मान् नो विजते लोको
लोकान् नो विजते चया
लोकान् नो विजते चया
हर्षम हर्षा भयोद्वेगे
हर्षम हर्षा भयोद्वेगे
मुक्ताया साच मे प्रिया
मुक्ताया साच मे प्रिया
यस्मान् नो विजते लोको
लोकान् नो विजते चया
हर्षमर्षा वयोद्वेगे
मुक्तो वः स च मे प्रिया
मुक्तो या सा च मे प्रिया
अस्तु साइकिल
यस्मान् नो द्विजते लोको
लोकान् नो द्विजते चया
हर्षमर्षा वयोद्वेगे
Yasmat,
from whom?
Never.
Udvijate,
are agitating.
Loka,
people.
Loka,
from people.
Never.
Udvijate,
is disturbed.
Cha,
also.
Ya,
anyone who.
Harsha, from happiness. Amarsha,
distress.
Baya,
fear.
Udvege,
and anxiety.
Mukta,
free.
Ya,
who.
Sa,
anyone.
Cha,
also.
Me,
to me. Priya,
very dear. Translation. He by whom no one is put into difficulty, and who is not disturbed by anyone, who is equipoised in happiness and distress, fear and anxiety, is very dear to me. Please repeat. He by whom no one is put into difficulty, and who is not disturbed by anyone,
who is equipoised
in happiness and distress,
fear and anxiety,
is very dear to me. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. A few of a devotee's qualifications are further being described. No one is put into difficulty, anxiety, fearfulness, or dissatisfaction by such a devotee. Since a devotee is kind to everyone, he does not act in such a way as to put others into anxiety. At the same time, if others try to put a devotee into anxiety, he is not disturbed. It is by the grace of the Lord that he is so practiced that he is not disturbed by any outward disturbance. Actually, because a devotee is always engrossed in Krishna consciousness and engaged in devotional service, such material circumstances cannot move him. Generally, a materialistic person becomes very happy when there is something for his sense gratification and his body. But when he sees that others have something for their sense gratification and he hasn't, he is sorry and envious. When he is expecting some retaliation from an enemy, he is in a state of fear. And when he cannot successfully execute something, he becomes dejected. A devotee who is always transcendental to all these disturbances is very dear to Krishna. Om
Shri Advaita Gadara, Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhaktarinda, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Lord Krishna is describing some of the different characteristics of a devotee. Lord Krishna in this 12th chapter had described that Bhakti Yoga, one who's engaged in devotional service, is better than one who's thinking of the impersonal Brahman. And now he's describing some of the different qualities which a devotee should have. By practicing devotional service, of course, he's expecting one will develop good qualities. There's a verse, Yashyasti Bhakti Bhagavati Akinchana. Sarvaya gunaistatra samaste suraha harava bhaktasya kuto mahadgana mahmanorate nasati bhavatova. The meaning is that for one who is a devotee of the Lord, it's understood that he's developing all the good qualities because the demigods are all pleased with him. They bestow their blessings on that person. But one who is not a devotee, even though he may be very expert in controlling the mind and senses, and practicing mystic yoga and drilling the respiration, but if he's not a devotee, then he's struggling with the modes of nature. And it's understood he does not really have any good qualities. Because sometimes he's in the mode of goodness, sometimes he's in the mode of passion, sometimes he's in the mode of ignorance. He's under the control of the three modes. So it's very important to take up devotional service. And the characteristics, behavior of a devotee are being described here. That because the devotee is Krishna conscious, that even though people may try to give him trouble, he doesn't worry about it. He's indifferent to it. He's equipoised. Just like we see Sukadeva Goswami. Sukadeva Goswami was going naked as a young man. He was going naked and his hair was disheveled and he was wandering everywhere and other people, young people saw him and they were laughing at him and they were throwing things at him and ridiculing him. But he didn't get disturbed about it because he was fully Krishna conscious. He was Atmarama, right? Atmarama means he's taking pleasure in the self. One who has understood his self, his spirit, their spiritual identity as Brahman, then they take pleasure in the self, in the soul. They're not thinking about the body, they're not disturbed by things which happen to the body. There's also the example of the Brahmana from Avanti Desh, described in the, I think it's the 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. There was this one Brahmana, initially he was a wealthy person, but he was very miserly. He would never give his wife any money, never give the children any money, never paid the servants, gave everybody the worst food. He was very attached to his money, but what happened was people cheated him and he lost all his money. And when he lost all of his money, then his family and children and everybody, they all left him. and he was left all alone. So what did he do? He understood this is the plan of the Lord, and he decided to surrender to the Lord and became a sannyasi. And he had a begging bowl, and he would go begging, and people would spit in it, and people would pass urine in it, and do all horrible things. He had very less cloth, and people would steal his cloth. He'd hang it up to dry, and they would steal it. No, they gave him so much trouble. But how did he just tolerated it. Because he recited, there's a verse, which the Brahmin from Avantidesh says, which says that one should remain fixed in the super soul, the Lord in the heart. That he was fixed in that consciousness, his meditation was on the Lord in the heart. So he was completely indifferent to the bodily disturbances. Even though people gave him so much trouble, he tolerated it. Lord Chaitanya also says, you should tolerate, right? Be tolerant like the tree. Amanena manadena, offer respects to others, and not be anxious for respect for ourselves. So this is these are the qualities we want to try to acquire. That we want to become Krishna conscious, and accept all the difficulties which come. Tateno kampam susamikshamana unjana ivatman kripam rikapipakam rikvagvapu virvidadan namaste Chiveta yo mukti pade sadaya bhakt. One who tolerates all the disturbances which come, accepting them to be reactions due to his past sinful activities, but goes on with devotional service. He continues to engage in his service of the Lord, then that person is qualified to become the unalloyed devotee of the Lord. Right, we becoming a devotee doesn't mean we won't have difficulties. Sometimes people think, I'm a devotee, how could Krishna do this to me? I shouldn't get any troubles, I shouldn't get any difficulties. We had one young lady in another place, so she was supposed to marry to this one young man, and then the young man changed his mind. Young man had second thoughts. I think I don't want to get married. So she was very disappointed. It was quite a blow to her ego. But the devotees explained to her, this is the arrangement of Krishna, that you have to tolerate these things. Happiness and distress, they come like the winter and summer seasons. We should be very conscious about being too joyful, because with happiness comes distress, right? Two sides of the coin. Heads come with a tail. So with happiness comes distress. So we should never, with success comes failure. We cannot expect all the time to have everything our way, the way we want it. We have to be willing to accept the difficulties and at the same time go on with our devotional service. And the result is he becomes qualified to become my unalloyed devotee. Acharyas give the example, what does the son have to do to inherit the wealth of the father?
Just stay alive.
He just has to stay alive. Right. He just has to stay alive. Wait for the father to die. Right, and you get your father's wealth. You inherit the wealth of your father. So the point is that we are all the children of Krishna, and we just simply have to stay in devotional service. And the result is, if we remain alive in Krishna consciousness, we'll go back to the spiritual world. That's the idea. Stay alive in Krishna consciousness. You know, every day, try to do some seva, try to do some chanting. Every day, try to be a devotee. You know, we may not be very good devotees, but we try. Every day, have kirtan. Every day, try to get some prasadam. Every day, try to hear a little bit about Krishna. Keep us alive, keeps us alive in Krishna consciousness. Right? If we're missing these things, then you know death is coming close. You feel death coming close. So death is coming close. As the sun rises and sets every day, it reduces the duration of life for the materialistic people. But not for the devotees. Not for a devotee. For the devotees who are engaged in hearing and chanting the Lord, about the Lord, then they're not affected by the passing of the sun. Their duration of life stays the same. They're eternal. Of course, that's the example which is given. Eternal in the sense that our destination is the eternal abode, that we will go to be liberated in the spiritual world. So we have to learn to tolerate difficulties. Sometimes people come and give you a hard time. And you get a job sometimes and your boss can give you a hard time. Or maybe you're working with somebody and they don't like you and they try to give you a hard time. You know, sometimes you get neighbors giving you a hard time, you know. We were in Taiwan one time, we were renting one place in Taiwan. Oh, the neighbors, so nice. Yeah. The incense, you know, she was rock this incense and burn this incense all day, it's terrible. And then they cook, they burn this oil and spices, it's terrible. And oh, so wow, we had to get out quick, you know. We had to find some other place to go and live. Sometimes, you know, people just give you a hard time. So, what to do? They ask Prabhupada, what will you do if nobody becomes a devotee, if nobody joins you? Prabhupada said, we will go somewhere else. We'll just go somewhere else. Nobody joins you. There's so many other places to go. People will join. Right? So we have to tolerate all these things. Any questions?
In the third canto, I guess it's in the third canto, it's explaining about the development of the womb. So what should a brahmachari take moral from that chapters?
Well, he should understand how miserable it is in the womb. And he should be determined not to take birth again. That is the idea. Lord Kapila is describing the miserable condition of the child in the womb. Very uncomfortable, very painful. The child is in a helpless condition, twisted, and cannot move. Sometimes the mother drinks hot liquid and burns the skin of the child. Sometimes worms are in the body of the woman, they eat the child. The child's in agony. In a very difficult situation. And some children are enlightened and they pray to the Lord. They pray, please let me out and I will certainly worship you. If you let me out of this condition, I will certainly use my life to worship you. But when it comes time for the child to be released from the womb, often the child prays, I don't want to go. Because if I come out of the womb, all the problems will begin. As soon as the child comes out of the womb, the beautiful child. Oh, you know, and the child becomes enamored. Oh, you know, the child thinks, I'm so lucky. Actually, the child's crying. The child comes out of the womb, the child is crying. People are happy, oh, we have a child. But the child thinks, oh no, I've taken birth again. I have to go through again all the miseries of birth, growing up. The child, sometimes the mother feeds the child and the child doesn't want to eat. When the child's hungry, the mother doesn't feed the child. So many things, the child's in pain and can't tell the mother, the mother can't understand what's going on. So miserable condition. Birth is painful. Before birth, in the womb is also painful. So Lord Kapila is describing the nature of life. Before birth, the period of birth, growing up, then old age, the whole life is just miserable from beginning to end. You grow up and you're thinking, oh, when we go to college, you're thinking, once I graduate, I will enjoy. You know, I was thinking, when I finish my university, then I will enjoy. You know, then I will find real happiness. And before you go to college, you think, when I get into college, then I will enjoy. You know, now I'm at school, but once I get into college, I will enjoy. I'll be a student. And then when you're a student, when I graduate, then I will enjoy. And then when you graduate, then you, when I get married, then I will enjoy. You know, and it's just all miseries. It's all miseries, one after another. So many troubles, so many struggles.
Maharaj, I have one question. Like some people, they are two faces. They have two faces. Like if we talk something to them, they are different to us and different with others. Means if we share with something to them, they talk, you know, they say in front of us, we will not share with somebody, but they share to everyone. And that makes difference in the relations with other people. So what should we do? Like, we should talk with them or like?
What to do? Just tolerate.
Yeah.
What do they share? They have nothing to share, only yeah. their miseries, only their maya.
Yeah.
So if they don't share with you, you're lucky.
No, if we share something to them, they share with somebody, and sometimes that will make difference in relation with someone.
Well, you should share Krishna.
Yeah.
Share Krishna consciousness, share some spiritual knowledge, share something meaningful.
Yeah.
You want to share with people, you can share, give them Krishna, give them some knowledge of the soul, give them some stories from the Bhagavatam. Tell them something worthwhile. Otherwise, what do we have to share? Yeah, you can share the miseries of life. Oh, the suffering you can share. People don't like to admit their suffering. That's a problem. Even though they will complain they're suffering. But when you start telling them they're suffering, no, I'm not suffering. So sharing, yeah, we like to share. We like to share Bhagavad Gita, give them a sloka from Bhagavad Gita. Just try to keep them, give them some, try to uplift them out of the maya, out of the illusion. Just like that devotee, Bhamsidas Das Babaji, people would ask him, what do you think of the government? He would say, Govardhan? So you have to change everything. Like in Malaysia, they have this word, Hari Raya. Hari Rama. So you should say Hari Rama. Hare Rama, Hare. We say Hare Raya, it's a Muslim festival. We say Hare Rama. Want to bring them to Krishna consciousness. When people would ask Prabhupada, how old are you? And you say, I'm the same age as you. I'm a soul, so are you. Bring them, that's sharing. Bring them up to Krishna, bring them to the spiritual platform. Don't let them bring you down.
Okay. I have one question. While practicing devotional service also, we have so many bad qualities and inner desires that are there since so long. So we should tolerate them also?
Well, no, we should lament them, and we should fully engage in devotional service. Yeah, we have many bad qualities, but if we continue to engage in devotional service, then these bad qualities should be becoming less. They should be gradually changing. We should be giving them up gradually, without even thinking about it. Just simply by engaging in Krishna service. Just like the example is here, Magrari the hunter was trapping the animals, but then he became a devotee and he started chanting. And when he started chanting, he wouldn't even step on the insects. He just changed. So we see Prabhupada talks, he said, these young men, before they came, they were all dirty and dark-faced and miserable, but now they're all bright-faced, look like they came from Vaikuntha, you know, with their shaved heads and tilak and kuntimala. They look like they've come from Vaikuntha. So they change, people change. By devotion, just simply by engaging in Krishna conscious activity. Before becoming devotees, what we were doing, all nonsense activities. What were we doing? We were listening to rock music, watching all kinds of mundane movies. And now we're reading Bhagavad Gita and chanting Hare Krishna. Before we were staying up all night, now we sleep early and get up early in the morning. Yeah, it changed. We didn't think about it, it just changed. Before we hardly ever took a bath, now we take bath two or three times a day. Or you're wearing jeans, wash the jeans once a month.
Yes.
If you lived in England once a month, in England it's so wet, so damp, takes a month to dry. So now we wear a dhoti, and you wash the dhoti, hang it up. Dry in an hour or two.
And Maharaj, now the youths have, you know, stopped washing jeans because the CEO of the one of the jeans company said that you should not wash jeans. The more it gets older, the more it becomes better. So, you know, many of the youths have stopped washing jeans as well.
Yeah, right. Yeah, see, they wear the jeans with big holes in their knees. You buy them like that with big holes in their knees. We thought that was the fashion. We thought, wow, you get the new jeans and you go out and rub them, make a hole in them to make them look old. But when they're old and faded, then this is really good looking. I think that. So we're so conditioned. The blind follow the blind. Well, we were talking about faith yesterday. So blind faith, follow the acharyas. Why follow the big scientists, big demons, uncontrolled senses, atheistic, materialistic, sinful people? Why follow them? Follow the acharyas. Ramanuja Acharya, Madhva Acharya, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, follow these people. Bhagavad Gita ki
jai.
Prabhupada ki
jai.
Bahut premanand
jai.
Jai.
Jai.